So my name is Jack Dekkers. I have an accent almost like Thomas from a neighboring country, from the Netherlands. I was born in the Netherlands and grew up there. Actually, now I've spent, since last year, I spent more than half of my life in North America, actually. So I came to University of Wisconsin and I did my PhD there. So I started my training at the university in Wageningen in the Netherlands, which is the agriculture university in the Netherlands, the only agriculture university in the Netherlands. I did my bachelor and master's there in animal science and animal breeding. And then I went to Wisconsin for my PhD in dairy cattle genetics, dairy cattle breeding. And then I had the opportunity to work for 8 years as a faculty member at the University of Guelph in Canada. And then there was an opportunity here in 97, so I moved here in 1997, working in the area of animal breeding and genetics, specifically on the integration of molecular and quantitative genetics. And as Thomas said, there's some exciting things happening right now, which I'll tell you about, which have started to have the impacts in animal breeding, but are now also starting to have an impact in plant breeding. So I'll tell you about this. And this is, as Thomas said, I was invited to give a talk at the Illinois Corn Breeder School last Monday. And so this talk is sort of built around that one. I did add a few things to make it okay, so both animal breeders and plant breeders, we've been pretty successful at using this black box approach of quantitative genetics, which basically we know that the traits we're interested in, these quantitative traits, are affected by many genes, but we have no idea where the genes are, what their effects are. We do know that they affect phenotype and that there's a heritability that tells us how much of the variation in phenotype is due to genetics, but there's also a big environmental component. And we in animal breeding and also plant breeding, we'd be very effective at using these phenotypes to affect selection and make genetic improvement. And we've been using these best linear unbiased prediction methods to estimate breeding values of individuals using the individual's own phenotype and relatives to get the most accurate estimate of the breeding value of an animal, and so that we can use that to select the next, the parents to produce the next generation of individuals. And just to illustrate how successful this has been, this shows the genetic trend for milk yield in U.S. Holsteins, the sires, what's happening in the sires and what's happening in the cows. The sires are leading because most of the selection is on the sire side. And so over a 40-year period, there's been an increase of about 3,500 kilograms, and this is only the genetic part, so there's also improvements in management, and over this 40 years, production has almost doubled. Not quite, but it's almost doubled. So I felt pretty good about that until I came to the Illinois Corn Breeders School, and Richard Johnson put up these numbers. 1964 to 2010, what has happened in corn breeding. And 64 was actually the year that the corn breeder school started. Okay, so that's why the 64 is here. And what he was showing that yield has increased, has more than doubled. Okay, but at the same time, the price of corn, and I suppose these are averages, the price of the product has more than tripled. And the price of the germplasm, the seed, has increased by a factor of 35. Now, I was struck by that because if I think of what has happened in animal breeding, yes, we've also almost doubled performance. So that like I showed you, if you look at both genetics and management, but milk price hasn't really changed very much. And also the price of a unit of semen, of dairy bulls, hasn't changed very much. So I decided I'm definitely in the wrong field, and I know why Keith Boldman went from animal breeding to plant breeding, because definitely there's a lot more money in plant breeding than there is in animal breeding. We're not talking to the right economists. I'm not quite sure what it is. But it was quite striking, I thought, that although the improvement seems to be similar, that the prices involved are quite different. Anyway, so that's as an aside. That's the one thing I did learn from the corn breeder school, Thomas. But it has been very successful for many traits, where we've been able to improve levels of production and growth rate in pigs. We've made pigs a lot leaner. Chickens lay a lot more eggs, and chickens broilers grow a lot faster. But there's also been some traits where things haven't worked so well. And so this is a graph of what has happened to fertility, daughter pregnancy rate, fertility in cows, and that has actually gone down quite dramatically. And there's a negative correlation, genetic correlation between production and fertility. Cows that produce a lot, they put a lot of their energy into milk production and don't have enough energy to sustain reproduction. Okay. So there have been these negative consequences, and these are traits that are lowly heritable. They're very difficult to select for using quantitative genetics. Although there has been some changes now, because in the late 90s, genetic evaluations for daughter pregnancy were developed, and this decline of the leveling off of the decline likely reflects that that there is now some selection pressure put on these traits. Okay, the other thing, so although it has worked for quite a number of traits, there's also quite a number of other limitations apart from some of the traits not being difficult to improve. And that is, we have to, in dairy cattle, and take that as an example, to get an evaluation of how good a bull is, we have to do a progeny test. Because, of course, a bull doesn't produce milk. And so in order to, for example, if you look at this example, so we do use reproductive technologies to get more than one calf out of this cow. This, if you look at the pattern, it's quite a unique cow here, by the way. So this cow, using amber transfer, can produce a litter of calves. And if these are four bull calves, for example, the question then is, well, if you can only put one of these, for sale or for marketing, which one would you choose? And of course, at this point, there's no information to differentiate these four bull calves other than their looks, but that probably doesn't tell you a whole lot. So the way we get around that, the way we get information on that, is by putting them through a progeny test. And so from each of these calves, once they reach productive age that they can produce semen, inseminate a number of cows, or a sizable number of cows in the population, such that we get at least 80 daughters. And then the 80 daughters, they produce milk, and we then evaluate the bulls, these bulls, based on the performance of their progeny through the progeny test. So that works. We get the progeny test evaluation, but it takes a long time. It takes about 5 years to go through this process, and it's very costly also to maintain these bulls, to get the records. Huge cost associated with eventually identifying this superior bull, which is then his semen through AI is extensively marketed throughout the industry and globally, if it's a very good bull. So the limitations are the long generation interval, the high cost of progeny testing, and it's still difficult to improve these low heritable traits.
Thank you for watching the Agronomist Podcast. YouTube limits video lengths to 10 minutes. You can watch this seminar in its entirety at the Department of Agronomy website, www.agron.iastate.edu.